I'm Miguel Basurto. I'm the CEO of Neolife Capital. We are a private equity firm investing in the early stages of the Mexican Mayan real estate industry. Since 2017, we've been scouting and designing a business strategy to implement digital securities on the Mexican real estate industry, which you will learn more in the days to come. So welcome to the event of the future of money and securities. Fintech Connector, Sofia Gamboa, the co-community partner of Mexico, and I are very delighted to present you this amazing event with thought leaders from around the world with hands-on experience of digital securities, assets, and currencies. Please, we encourage all of you to use the questions and answers function on Zoom, vote on questions, and raise your hands during the event. We are starting this event with a keynote by David Seal on the future of money. David, please. I'll hand you.
Thanks. Can you hear me, Miguel?
Yes, perfectly.
Okay, great. I'm going to share my screen. My name is David Seal. I am an entrepreneur, a blockchain entrepreneur. I created the Pillar project in 2016, and I'm the author of a book on tokens and a book on digital money. I'm the former CEO of the second company in London to go through the FCA sandbox to digitize equity securities and several other things. So I'm going to talk mostly about money in this 10-minute keynote. That's going to be mostly about monetary policy because I care about the trillion-dollar things first, and then I care about the billion-dollar things next, and then I care a little bit about the million-dollar things, but not too much. So to focus on the big things, the things that have trillions of dollars at stake, to me, those are monetary policy and innovation. These two things are the drivers of our economy, and they are the drivers of what keeps people employed and helps them and either causes them to be unemployed or causes better quality of life for all. So I want to talk first about monetary policy. In 2008, there was a great financial crisis caused by a supply shock. It was, believe it or not, it was not enough housing in key cities. It wasn't really a subprime banking problem. It was a problem of supply of housing. And then the Fed responded with tight money, tight monetary policy that spiraled the economy into a recession that lasted quite a while and infected Europe, where the ECB actually raised interest rates and caused even more tight money. And that whole combination of bad monetary policy spiraled the world into 3 to 5 years of low employment and put about 2 billion people out of work. It was much more the result of monetary policy than anything else. Now, the current pandemic is different. It's also the money is too tight right now. Our monetary policies right now are too tight. They are not promoting expansion. But we're in a demand shock now, which is a very unprecedented thing, and most central bankers don't know how to deal with this. But even though you hear that the Fed has printed $2.3 trillion worth of money in the last 6 weeks, it isn't enough. U.S. inflation is going to fall far short of the goal of 2% this year. 2% is the target for many central banks, and they haven't hit it in a long time. So people don't really understand inflation because some people remember the 70s when inflation was very high. But if you look at the last 20 years, inflation has not hit its target. Here I put the 2% target in red, and the Fed has not hit their target. They've undershot the 2% target, and that limits the growth of the economy. It limits the amount of money available in the economy for people to spend and grow and innovate. And in Japan, it's been much worse. So most central banks are undershooting their inflation targets, and that holds us back as a world society and economy. right now, after $2.3 trillion of announced, you know, money printing more or less from the Fed, it's a complicated set of programs, inflation is running how high right now? Less than 0.5% in the United States. Less than 0.5%. Inflation has no chance to get to 2% by the end of this year. It'll probably come in under 1% this year. And that's bad. That's what we don't want. We want to try to keep our economy at about 2%. And there, it's not going to happen this year, but the Fed is trying. And the Fed is going to have to put more money in circulation. They're going to have to print more. They may have to print more than $2, 3, 4 trillion more, depending on how this pandemic plays out, just to keep sliding into deflation. They're going to have to print more if things get worse, because people are not traveling, they're not buying things. If you know, a really good way to measure inflation is by the prices you see anecdotally. Do you notice prices going up or prices going down? You notice that anybody selling anything is trying to make the sale and get, and so has to lower prices to get people to buy, to get the economy going again, to just be in business. You have to lower prices because of the demand shock. So whoever's afraid of hyperinflation, and there are a lot of people talking about hyperinflation, there are a lot of rich people talking about hyperinflation, they don't understand monetary policy. They don't really understand money. They just have anecdotal memories of the 1970s or of Zimbabwe or of Venezuela that just doesn't have any relevance to today's economy. So let's look at digital money. So just for context, it's important that monetary policy is far more important than digitizing money. If we digitize the monetary policies we have today, it's not going to be much progress. Still, many, many people will be out of work, and we'll have long-lasting recessions, or might have a very difficult recovery from this one. But to look at digital money, when you think of making a new form of digital money, there's one word you have to keep in mind more than anything else. Oh, I'm going to have to come back to nominal GDP level targeting. This is what I recommend. This is a monetary policy that will work and that will be much better for the economy and help us avoid deep recessions. So there's one word you have to keep in mind when digitizing money, and that is compliance. You're going to need licenses, compliance people, audits, a team of expensive consultants. You're going to have to be compliant with dozens of laws that don't work. Compliance is the opposite of innovation. Most regulations don't actually keep people safe. They are designed to make politicians look tough and get reelected. Let's start with anti-money laundering. So look, each year worldwide, we spend about $600 billion on anti-money laundering compliance. Okay, $600 billion is what that's our cost. And so what do we get for that $600 billion? Well, each year, every year, year after year after year, those compliance people catch about $3 billion of illegal money or illicit transactions out of $3 trillion of money successfully laundered every single year. 3 billion out of 3 trillion, that's 0.1%. So does this look like it's working? It's probably the world's most failed regulatory intervention ever. In fact, it's even better for criminals. Criminals love it because it gives them legitimacy. It makes it easier to launder money, and the banks participate. Banks do a lot of work to help criminals launder money, and it prevents innovation. So big banks have no problem paying the fines. Last year was the second highest year for fines against anti-money laundering violations. It was more than $10 billion in the United States last year. So banks have no, you know, this is just a cost of doing normal business, and it should be clear that it doesn't work. Now, I want to talk quickly about bank regulations, because if you're going to have some kind of a digital coin, you're going to have to be compliant, and you're going to need some banking licenses, and how is that going to work? Well, there are two models. I want to present the cash model here, where the exchanges have to be regulated, but there are other wallets where the coins can go. They can go to Zimbabwe, they could go to Venezuela, they can go wherever they want and then come back. And when you hit the exchange again to cash out, they're gonna ask you for your source of funds. And where did that money go? And where is it coming from? And most people will have a hard time answering that. And the truth is that there could be lawsuits and infringements and all kinds of problems. Your stable coins may be worth less depending on their history. Who's had them might affect the value of your stable coin, as it does with Bitcoin today. Or the other model is the e-money model, where everything is in a sealed ecosystem. And this is probably where Libra will end up and where many other projects will end up, so that they are fully compliant and every wallet is observable and is compliant with AML. And so that's just like PayPal. That's just reinventing PayPal with maybe some plumbing in the middle that saves a bit of money, but all the licensing, all the ineffective compliance all applies. And look, the government will have access in this model to any transaction and anyone's identity to see everything. And so that's a tool for the surveillance state. And this signals the end of end-to-end encryption. It takes away privacy. But this is what we're looking at when we talk about digital money right now, because regulators can't find a way to do anything other than just turn these things into banking networks that they already know. So look, it's going to be real simple to make digital money. This is the roadmap to digital money. No problem. One of the most important things is scale. The first $200 billion is always the hardest, and it's necessary to get to scale to have any kind of a reasonable chance to develop a digital money ecosystem. It's going to have to be fully compliant, and there are lots and lots of things that could trip it up. So to me, it's more important to look at the regulatory environment and to question whether we are doing the right things without blockchain before we add blockchain to the existing set of rules and regulations. I think it's time to look really hard at how we govern and how we set the rules and whether the rules work or not before we go digitizing things. Regulation is the opposite of innovation. You can see it in the response to the pandemic right now. Many lives have been lost because of regulation here in the United States. This is not going to lead us into the 21st century unless we can first ask ourselves some hard questions and go toward agile governance before we get all excited about the million-dollar questions of how to tokenize. I'll stop there.
Okay, we have one question so far. Please post your questions. The question that we have here is from William Friedman. How can money be too tight when target Fed fund rates are essentially at 0%? Thoughts?
Yeah, this is because interest rates don't matter much. What matters is the natural rate of interest. And at the end, what the problem is, there isn't enough money in circulation. That's called reasoning from a price change. You see interest rates at zero, and so you say, oh, we must have plenty of, expansive monetary policy. That's not true. We don't have nearly enough money in circulation. And you can just look at the inflation figures right now. We're less than 0.5%. So it's a common misconception that zero interest rates mean that the level of interest rates means that monetary policy is expansionary or contractionary. It's not true. It's relative to the amount of money in circulation, and it's relative to the growth of the economy at the time. Right now, the economy is really slowed down, and so zero is not enough. It's not enough firepower. You have to do much more than drop interest rates. You have to print money. We're not printing enough. But wait, should we go to the panel? Diane.
Okay, so yeah. let's turn that over now. Thank you, David, for that, and we're going to turn it over to Dan.
Yes, thank you, Angel, and thank you, David, for the presentation and giving us a backdrop of what our chat will be about. So I kind of wanted to just shift to just presenting who our panelists will be. As you guys know, David Siegel, he is the blockchain innovator, entrepreneur, and author. We also are joined by Tony Evans, who is a co-founder of FGC Group, and Gowri, CEO of Grip DIFC Limited, as well as Vishal Shah, founder of Alpha 5. So I will be moderating the panel. I am an NYC community partner for the FinTech Connector, as well as the director of brand and content at Tika Solutions. So without further ado, let's just begin. I'll have each of you guys kind of tell a little bit about yourselves, just a brief background, and we'll start with Tony, since you're to my right.
Thank you very much, Mude. Yes, my name is Tony Evans. I'm based out in Tokyo most of the time. Our company specializes in finance for blockchain and cryptocurrency. We have a global network specializing in investors and in businesses, and we've just started innovating by focusing on failed projects and revamping them and giving them a new life. So we focus on value for clients, investors, and projects.
Great. We'll just move on to Vishal Shah.
Yes, hi. I'm Vishal. I've been in the space for a little over 4 years. My background is mostly derivatives trading. We've started Alpha 5, which is aiming to port legacy market infrastructure into the crypto world to show some sort of corporate responsibility and to provide a better infrastructure for trading, clearers, custodians, etc. And we're looking to kind of contribute in whichever way we can in terms of developing that derivatives market.
Awesome. And Gowri, you're up next.
Hello. I'm CEO of Grip DIFC Limited. We're an investment bank based out of the Dubai International Financial Center. We are regulated by the Dubai Financial Services Authority, and our service focus spans three verticals: investment banking services, wealth management, and a private securities trading.
Awesome. All right. So just to kind of get a lay of the land and to start kind of from a macro level. So, you know, David, I'll turn this over to you since you kind of mentioned it in your keynote, but, you know, what is the macro view of digital money? Is it in demand? David, you're up. Did we lose David? David Siegel?
Oh, sorry. I'm not. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
I'm not allowed to turn on my video because it's maybe Angel has. Okay.
All right. We're all good.
Is there a demand for digital money? Well, there's demand for more than $2 billion worth of Tether. Right, so the exchange, it's a tool for exchanges, right? Like at most exchanges, you can go to exchange dollars. You could go to Binance dollars or Poloniex dollars, and those are probably a little more vulnerable than Tether. Tether is probably a better product for that. So there's plenty of demand for crypto traders. That's a small market. The whole crypto market is very small, right? It's a couple hundred billion dollars, but obviously we have tremendous demand to send money across borders and small payments to enable micropayments. So there's tremendous demand for innovation in money, and digital money is clearly the way forward.
So do you think that there is a roadblock right now? I mean, I know you talked a little bit about monetary policy and compliance. I would assume that has a lot to do with it. You know, can we get sort of a view of you know, what that looks like, you know, how we can actually move this innovation forward, because, you know, we do want to meet this demand. And is there anything else that stands in the way?
Maybe some of the panels with CC prod for digital currency. That's probably where it's going to go. And so there are a lot of issues there. There's no reason to get into all the details. But central banks are interested and scared at the same time of having kind of retail accounts for their own, you know, is the central bank really the bank of everybody? We're going to try it. In China, they're not doing that. In China, they're doing a two-level approach where it's more of a wholesale token, and then there will be the retailers that then handle the wallets and the consumer interface. That'll be an interesting experiment. But I'm sure that if you go forward 50 years, everything is digital. So it's just a matter of how we're going to sort of lurch our way there.
Yeah. And Vishal, kind of same question for you, since you know you have some experience understanding the CBDC process. So just wanted to pass that over to you in terms of, you know, any roadblocks in terms of getting digital money to actually come to the forefront.
Yeah, so I mean, I'd actually take a step back and I'd say that digital money in its definition just simply means a digital IOU for a dollar, a physical dollar, physical euro, whatever it is, right? In that respect, as far as it facilitates commerce, it kind of almost already exists, right? It doesn't have this tokenized identity. It doesn't have this blockchain identity. But if you look at a lot of these emerging markets, they have these great payment systems that are instantaneous transfers of wealth, instantaneous transfers of rupees or CNY or whatever you want to look at. What the blockchain is enabling for this is a ledger, right? And this is where the central banks come into play. They're not interested in this for the purposes of necessarily, having this digital parallel to their, you know, physical counterpart. It's really more so for the fact that they're getting a ledger, right? When the government is empowered with the ability to track wherever its currency is going to be at any given point in time, that is absolutely enormous. They will be able to then look at taxation, circumvention of any sort of capital controls, and they'll have a real-time analysis of where their currency ends up. That is the real value of having a digital money basis as we're kind of seeing it. And we're seeing China take the lead on this, right? This is something that, you know, I think we alluded to the fact that, you know, Libra is something that tried to do it from a private sector perspective and get the right counterparts on board with it. But what we've seen is that China's really realizing the real value for this. And as they're doing that, you're going to have everybody kind of latch onto the coattails and realize what's actually at stake here. It's definitely the way forward. It's a matter of when, not if. But I think that it's precarious for those that actually just haven't been exposed to the sector. And until we see a changing of the guard in terms of younger leaders, younger regulators kind of come on, I don't think you're going to get a full-fledged overturn of the system. So it's pipeline, but as David's already pointed out, I think it's an evolution process, and we're along that path.
All right, great. And so I guess back to you, David, and then we'll move on to digital securities after this one. But what is your view on different types of governments trying to implement this? We mentioned China. Do you see any other regions kind of helping or hurting this cause? Where do you see this fall?
There's a lot of experiments. I'm not interested in little countries. Cambodia, Bahamas, these are small things that won't matter. But, Sweden is looking pretty hard at it. Sweden is already the most cashless country in the world. I agree with Vishal that governments are interested in seeing the ledger. I'm very concerned about privacy for good reason. And also, it makes everything cheaper when you use a blockchain, a single ledger to manage everything. You can take out much of the machinery we have today for reconciliation and managing system-to-system transfers. So it really promises to enable tremendous innovation for low-income people around the world. That's why they started Libra, I believe. And it's really in very experimental laboratory conditions from London to Canada to kind of the Fed. I guess that there will be more of this innovation will start at the plumbing and the bank to bank kind of things like Ripple and like the Fed coin, Fedwire, and then eventually get to the consumer interface, but probably not for a while. But the China experiment will be interesting.
So turning over to you, Gowrie, and actually switching gears a little bit to digital securities, can you just tell us kind of just briefly what they are, the different types that exist, and what sort of separates digital securities from traditional securities?
Sure. So in its purest form, digital security is what differentiates a digital security from a conventional security is that apart from the fact that the ownership can be registered on a blockchain and the ownership transfer of ownership can then be monitored via that ledger, everything else, every single attribute that relates to a conventional security in its analog form, be it a share, bond, a unit of fund or a LPGP interest, anything, be it whatever it may be, it does not change. The only key thing that digital securities do is that they are issued on a distributed ledger, their ownership is recorded on a distributed ledger, and the transfer of ownership then has to happen on that ledger. So instead of having a ledger that is maintained in a company's house or the equivalent of that and going through the analog process, if it can happen via a distributed ledger, the transfer of that security, that's what clearly differentiates a conventional security in its analog form to a digital security. Apart from this, nothing else is different in a digital security. And your second question is how does this impact capital markets?
Yeah, we can definitely move to that now. Yeah, sure.
Yeah, so in terms of capital markets, I think the most profound impact digital securities can have, initially at least, will be within the private securities market, because within the public securities market, they are within walled gardens, which are like the exchanges. But whereas in the private securities market, if one were to engage in a transaction, one has to go through the whole rigmarole of having multiple intermediaries step in to give trust to the transfer of ownership associated with that private company's shares, bonds, or private, any form of private security. Whereas if that can be digitized via a ledger, then the transferability within that private securities market can be made more efficient. This correspondingly or consequently can then make that private securities market more accessible, or basically it can disintermediate trust and eliminate the multiple intermediaries that one has to go through, or the hoops one has to jump within that private securities market, eliminate that. So from that point of view, it can bring forth variety of efficiencies into that private securities market. Secondly, it can enable a wider pool of capital accessible for private securities. And from that point of view, what I'm trying to refer is that if you want to buy a private company or a private security in a jurisdiction which is slightly alien to you or unknown to you, if one can derive trust on the process of transfer of ownership related to that security in that jurisdiction, that's one less headache for you to worry about. And you can then focus only on the investment merits associated with that security, as opposed to worrying about the investment merits related to that security, also the jurisdiction specific legalities and the modalities of transfer of ownership and so forth. At least that bit can be handled in a relatively a seamless way if that can be done. So that's where I probably believe that the most efficiencies can be brought in. Then, of course, you can talk about fractional ownership, more liquidity and so forth. But these can already be, I mean, it can be done now as well. But the transformative impact is when the ownership of a security can be on the ledger for a private security. I believe that's the key thing. And the court of law, or in the eyes of the law, when an ownership is of a private security is mentioned on a ledger, that needs to be accepted. There needs to be changes related to company's law to accept this. That's when you'll have the highest level of impact coming in, and or rather, that's when this technology can have its most profound and maximum impact.
So, you know, you mentioned a lot about kind of private securities. And so, you know, my, I guess, question to, let's say, you know, Tony, you know, where do you see that this will have, you know, liquidity and staying power? You know, have you had any experiences with, you know, digital securities that you can kind of speak to that, you know, it went successfully and you're able to just see that actually, you know, benefit the company that is involved?
Of course, the whole thing is, the digital security is a form of transferring the ownership, and that has been the main thing. So we've been using it quite a lot by using traditional methods of companies' house and everything like that and holding the assets inside of it. We focused a lot that there has to be a hybrid at the moment between the ledger and the traditional ways of doing it, because if we're going to be focusing so much on the technology side and focusing on the blockchain, then the traditional side of it would fall out, and that would be a big problems. In Asia, especially in Tokyo, is still very traditional. Even if it is very technologically advanced, you have to basically do a hybrid of the ledger and the traditional. And that has been very successful by digitalizing the shares of a company and then holding the assets inside of it. That keeps everybody happy. The government, AML, KYC, and also from a accountability of the transactions. You can see it all on the ledger.
Great. So I guess if we look at the current landscape of digital securities, let's go back to actually Vishal with you. What has been your experience in successful digital securities, I guess, use cases and ones that you can speak to?
Well, it's no surprise that, you know, with the advent of, you know, this technology, everybody kind of rushed to create a purpose for almost every sort of asset in terms of getting digitized. That was the wrong way of doing it, right? Where we see the real applications are where opacity is turned into transparency, right? And this has to do with where you can generate a mark-to-market valuation, where there isn't one right now, or where it's highly ambiguous. So you're talking about venture funds, right? Or say you own a set of companies, privately owned, as we referred to earlier. Well, what are they worth? You have a fund that invests in them. Well, we don't really know because they have X, Y, Z valuations, different rounds, et cetera. If you go ahead and you digitize this, or you create a fractional digital ownership, all of a sudden you enable the market to take a mark-to-market view on this. That's a real value add. If you go and simply take a piece of real estate and, you know, digitize ownership, aside from the initial, I guess, friction that you would probably ease, and which is probably the right course of action over many years, maybe not immediately, because it involves an entire infrastructure overhaul, then, you know, you're not going to get any real, you know, material benefits, at least on the margin, is the way I see it. So assume, for instance, take another example, ETFs, right? There are a few ETF providers globally right now considering overhauling a lot of their issuance into tokenized versions of shares, as opposed to putting out an exchange-traded fund, they'll issue the token version. That's an infrastructure overhaul process that takes many, many years to implement. If that is part of the longer, you know, longer term capex, that's absolutely fine. If it's being done to service an appeal to create an instrument that really doesn't have any material marginal benefit at source, that's the wrong way of approaching it. You're going to be in for a lot more than you think, and you're going to be in it for a lot longer than you think. So coming back to the broader question, I would say that yes, there is a benefit, but it has to be very directed. There are only a few industries that avail themselves to be used right now for this. You know, if healthcare is potentially one, venture is potentially another one. Most other industries, especially finance, I'm not necessarily convinced that we're at a point of reckoning there.
So that's interesting about industries, because I think that people want to know, you know, which industries will be affected first. And so, Gowri, I wanted to get your perspective, because I know you've had some real-world kind of tangible, I guess, experience with looking at the different types of industries and seeing which ones are going to be affected by this first. So what do you think is the priority here as far as that goes?
Yeah. So I'll tell you from my personal experience. So sitting here in Dubai, we are a city for the world. We're literally in the center of the world and are, you know, home to 200 nationalities here. So our exposure on and whatever we do is revolves around servicing the world. We build bridges to our neighbors. So if you see the kind of people that we are working with and the transactions that we would be bringing forth to the market where those entities would be issuing digital securities, primarily, yes, it started off with real estate related ventures, given that the organic or the indigenous investor base is most familiar with real estate here, and there is interest for that. Yes, it started with real estate. I believe the next would be financial services, and the reason why I believe it would be financial services is that financial services firm, be it anyone who is adopting technology, is also looking to have their cap table managed via digital securities issuance, because they are able to move to that faster. They are able to appreciate the nuances related to having a digital security next. And the third probably would be the technology guys. And I don't mean the hardcore tech side of businesses, but tech related to consumer services, because digitizing and having the digital security issued enables them to have a wider shareholder base and also to go right into their consumers and have, because if you see what's, and that could probably be a phenomenon that we see more moving forward as well, post this, once the dust settles on this crisis, is that more and more companies might want to be owned by their employees and also by their consumers. They like to have a portion of their cap table allocated to this. And the most easiest way to do that is where by having a digital security or a representation of some form of ownership represented by that. So from that point of view, these industries could come first, but I don't see a reason why digital securities have to only cater to a particular industry. I believe it is agnostic. It's because it doesn't change anything. If there is an indigenous demand emanating for a particular industry or a particular sector, then it doesn't really matter that having a digital securities issued is going to augment that demand or decimate it. It just means that it increases the efficiency of ownership into that industry. So from that point of view, yes, I believe it's going to be agnostic, and anybody who wants to adopt it and anybody who where there can be investor demand for from any industry can use this technology to improve efficiencies and efficiencies related to their cap table management, and also augment the process related to, of course, second market price discovery or transferability related to that security. So I believe digital securities are sector agnostic.
Great. And turning to you, Tony, if you look at the technology versus the business side of things, can you walk us through the mechanism behind, you know, all of these things? If let's say I wanted to raise money and I wanted to do it through, you know, with a digital security, you know, can you just tell us, you know, what people need to think about when they're doing all of this and how they could approach it essentially?
So I'm not the expert of the technology, I'm an expert on the finance, so I'm going to give you from my point of view. The main focus of it is where the business is located. The one thing that we've seen with a lot of issuance of digital securities or digital tokens is the legal aspect afterwards. It's not the legal aspect as people are raising money, it's the legal aspect afterwards. That's the one thing that we always advise people to do is, okay, where is your jurisdiction, where are you going to operate, and where is your assets held? Okay, that's the first one. Second one is working with partners that can actually create the actual digital securities and also have the ability to issue it and also give you liquidity. Because the one thing is a very simple point of view is it's very easy to invest into anything. It's always hard to get your money out of any investment or any situation. So I'm always one that always looks at it, okay, if you're raising money, fine, okay, but where is the exit strategy? How is that happening? So working with companies that can help you with the aftermarkets and everything like that is a very, very important in my sense. And there's a lot of options now from the people looking at this, but I would say look at it from a geographical point of view and also from a point of view of future expansion as well.
Do you see, like, which partners would you kind of seek out for something like this?
In what do you mean?
Let's say if you wanted to go through an issuance, you know, who do you need to be on your team to let this, to allow this to happen? You know, can do you have any examples of companies that you've worked with to enable this?
Sure, the whole, in Japan, there's a company called Anno Zamori. They're one of the pioneer in regards to the legal side of things. We've always found if it's easier to work with the legal side of it, because they can then build the building blocks for the financial side of it and then building it upward. I believe having a strong legal foundation will be the key for them to actually build it up from there. Then the next part of it is looking at the your human resources. Who have you got in your team that A, it might be missing, or B, that might be needing some extra expertise in there. And then the technology part of the actual issuance, there's so many different companies around the world. It just depends more on exactly the location and jurisdiction of it. Okay. So I'm very, very paranoid of in this, because I've seen so many businesses lose money, raising money, and then there's going to be a legal action that stops everything, and then they have to go back to fix that before moving forward. Time is the only asset that you cannot get back. So focusing on what saves you time and makes it more efficient is another part of my thought process.
And I guess when we think about liquidity, right, do you think that there is liquidity in this sector? And if so, you know, why aren't institutional investors seeing it the same way? And do you believe that they are actually participating in this industry? Because it just seems like they're only kind of dipping their toe in still. And there hasn't been that mass adoption on their side. So yeah, talk a little bit about liquidity and the investors that you're seeing involved.
The one thing is people forget that this industry, I call this industry, probably is about 5-6 years old when the actual adoption of it became more and more towards business and finance, okay? It's only 6 years old. The whole crypto market is only worth around 270, 280 billion, okay? If that was a company in America, it wouldn't be a large company. Most of the large corporations in America have more cash on their balance sheets than they have of the whole marketplace. So we have to put this into perspective, okay? The marketplace is very, very young, and the adoption of it is coming slowly through. You've seen recently JP Morgan's now accessed given accounts to Gemini. You've now seen Visa coming out with the adoption of a blockchain crypto patent. The one thing is, it is moving forward. In regards to investors, okay, everybody invests in digital currency, digital assets in some shape or form, okay, because nobody actually sees assets these days. They just believe what they see on screens. And that has always been something in my head. It's like people believe what they see on screens. Nobody's, like, investors have never gone to a bank and asked, can I see my $1 million? You just say, okay, that's my money, that is it. Yeah? And the you said about liquidity. They are liquidity providing in the marketplace. There's a lot of providers out there in regards to exchange, but also secondary markets. You've got the likes of SharePost that actually allows liquidity. We're doing a lot of OTC deals ourselves to provide liquidity for clients, but either giving them loans against their digital assets or providing it, structuring it between institutions. And the institutions are in the marketplace, maybe not in the hundreds of billions, but they are there and they are investing. Even traditional companies are investing in this, because this is the future. This is what internet was 15, 20 years ago. People understand this is the way forward.
And Vishal, kind of same question goes to you by, you know, your viewpoint on the liquidity, you know, issue, if you don't think there is an issue there, and the types of investors that you're seeing getting involved in this space.
Yeah, so I would actually probably take a different view here, which is that liquidity is a massive issue. A lot of investors will not get involved because the market cap of say, if you look at just cryptocurrency, does not enable them to invest any sort of material allocation to get any sort of real return. This is having spoken to a number of global macro investment managers who manage, you know, in the billions of dollars, right? A few are kind of trickling in. That will probably be a long-winded process. But I think that's separate to the story of, do financial institutions actually participate and see value in the securitization or the digitization of any sort of their processes, right? What we saw, say, let's, you know, backtrack about a couple of years. We saw a number of consortia come out, right? You had R3, you had Corda. I mean, I'm sure you've seen these headline numbers come up. Where are they now? What happened is a lot of banks got together and said, this is great. We'll create something here, right? They couldn't agree. One jumped from the other jumped from the other. Some got involved with Ripple, some didn't. Some said, we're gonna go out and do it on our own. The capitalist zeal overtook the idea of kind of creating something that enabled, you know, a more of a altruistic approach, which is really weird because the irony in this is that, you know, this is a grounds up type of approach where you kind of try to implement a blockchain because it is distributed, highly distributed, and people couldn't agree on how to actually do it. You know, a lot of guys said, we're going to do our own private chain. You had the likes of Ripple pump more money into MoneyGram than their whole entire market cap is, right? This is not sustainable in that sense. I don't think we found that common ground, which is going to enable this, right? Every now and then you see something come through, Santander issues a bond on Ethereum or whatever it is on some sort of chain. That's fine. People are definitely dabbling. I think it's just a longer evolution process. And I don't think we've seen the crystallization of what that product or what that, you know, I guess, process is going to be around which there is going to be a services industry necessarily. It's very tempting to template what we know from legacy markets into this market and say, well, yeah, this just makes sense. This is how we'll do it. I think it's far more nuanced than that. And as a result, what we've seen from that trial and error and the heuristics here is suggesting that this is going to be far more tempered than, you know, our euphoric ideals would like us to kind of lead us to believe.
So David, kind of over to you, what do you believe is the investment opportunity for digital securities?
First of all, I think I pretty much agree with everybody, which is always a tragedy because it's more fun to fight and have disagreements. The only disagreement I have is with Vishal, because I don't think that we will magically have mark-to-market kind of real-time pricing of very, very illiquid things just because they're digital. I mean, we might get a little more data, but it will take a long time. What tells you the price of something is when one person is willing to sell something to somebody else. Analysts don't have any idea what the price of anything is. So liquidity brings price information. You know, prices are information. So when you have very thinly traded startups or even private equity, it's very, very challenging to get prices, whether you're, you know, it can change day to day, whether they're digital or not. But that's all just a matter of, I hope, more liquidity coming to these markets so that imagine a market where you could trade startup stock, where you could trade PE, where there was much more liquidity and you had much more buyers and sellers, but that's all gonna depend on regulation, right? So where are the opportunities? I think they're mostly in the plumbing between institutions. Do I wish that we could have end-to-end, you know, fully encrypted transfers from person to person? Of course, but that's just illegal for securities in most countries. And it's going to be illegal for money. It's kind of a miracle that Ethereum and Bitcoin have gotten a pass so far and are more or less outside of regulation. We could just move these things, although there's still plenty of compliance with the travel rule and you know, how much money you can move around. You can go to jail by selling someone some Bitcoin. If you sell somebody more than $10,000 worth of Bitcoin without going through an exchange, that's illegal. So it's going to be a while before the front facing, before the last mile is conquered, because that's just going to require regulatory change. But that's why I say that the plumbing from institution to institution is probably the place for most innovation at the moment.
So I guess staying with you here, David, you know, let's look at the current you know, economic landscape that we're seeing as a result of the pandemic. I think people are really wild and hot about stablecoins. And do you think that they will be an impact in kind of quelling this situation that we're in? You know, how do you think we're going to
prepare as to situation, which is keeping people from going to work. I mean, there's no economics that changes that. There's nothing the Fed or the government right. can do economically to put people back to work. That's going to take, you know, treatments, testing, maybe some vaccines or some preventatives. That's just going to be a lot of medical advances that I hope, you know, by September we have a reasonable amount of return to the economy. On the recovery side, it's all about policy. It's not demand for digital anything that is going to recover these economies. I mean, these economies are not essentially digital, and the digital is just still more or less, when we talk about digital, you know, single ledger and shared ledger types of solutions aren't going to make much of a difference. Again, they will probably factor into supply chains and, you know, moving data from institutions to institutions where there's no trust, right? So certain kinds of drugs, certain kinds of PPE and equipment that is easily falsified or that people are scamming, that much of that trust can be put on a blockchain. But transactionally, we get out of this first, and then we go back to trying to innovate on the digital front.
All right. So I guess, you know, before we get into questions, I just wanted to give a question to basically all of our panelists, kind of starting with the gallery. You know, how do you think it will impact, you know, the future of money? How will digital securities impact the future of money? Do you think it'll help push decentralized finance forward? You know, like if you had a crystal ball, you know, where do you see us kind of headed?
Okay, sans the crystal ball, for a transaction to happen in a digital security and for that transaction to happen real time where the ownership is transferred and the settlement proceeds are transferred all on the ledger, you need some form of digitized medium of exchange. And that's when a true trade happens. So unlike now in an exchange, the settlement cycles are T+2 or T+3, whereby the transaction life cycle is actually completed in 2 days, and there is a settlement risk which exists within that ecosystem. Yeah. Whereas if on a distributed ledger, if you are going to transfer a digital security and settle it real time, when the ownership of the digital security transfers, the corresponding proceeds related to that also need to transfer via the same medium. And for that, you need some form of digitized representation of money. And from that point of view, for a true sale to happen within a digital security ecosystem, you need something like, you know, you need a stable coin or ideally a central bank issued digital currency. So then, you know, everything can happen. So if one were to look at that, and if you can push forward within on that line of thought, then, yeah, so the adoption of some form of digital money is part and parcel of a true digital security ecosystem evolving, and that's very important. Does this crisis improve the adoption of those? Maybe, but first we'll have to solve the basic problems, that is to get the economy back on track in terms of activity and things like that, because unlike in a, say, if the fire had burned through the city, we would see the collateral damage. Now we don't see collateral damage, but there are bazookas which have gone through banks' balance sheets, and we will only see that when the quarterly accounts come in the next couple of quarters. and that's just banks. I mean, it has gone through all corporates and stuff like that. So you need to get the economy, the cogs of the wheel spinning again within the economy. And then it's only that after that, you know, you need to satisfy basic needs first and then go on to building on. So from that point of view, probably if these solutions are going to augment that process of getting to that recovery mode fast, yes, will improve the government strategy here within the UAE or and Dubai in particular. So the state policy now is charted towards for us to emerge as the fastest in the world in terms of recovery, and also to emerge as far stronger than where we were pre-crisis level. And a key strategy towards that is to digitize everything within the economy. So all the government services now are predominantly digitized. All the services will move towards. So during this crisis, even though we were in lockdown, we were able to do pretty much any government services you wanted because they were available via a digital form. I can have petrol. Of course, I might not use the car, but you know, I could have the fuel delivered to my house and my car refueled, or even a can of Coke delivered home. That's the kind of delivery ecosystem that's there. The support services were working. Now, the next phase is to make sure how far every aspect within this economy can be digitized. So when an economy is going to chart a course like that, then we need e-currency as well, or digital currency, to facilitate that activity, that transaction, the medium. So from that point of view, yes, within at least talking from a UAE or Dubai point of view, yeah, the digitization of money is a critical pillar within the ecosystem. And in that sense, yes, we might see more adoption. But is it going to be a central bank issued digital currency, or is it some form of e-representation of money, or e-money as it's known? I don't know which will come first. I believe it might be e-money first and then central bank digital currency.
So same question for you, Tony. How do you believe you know, this pandemic or in general will impact the future of money, or just where do you see it fall kind of moving forward?
You're on mute, Tony.
Thank you, David. Sorry, I was already far ahead in my head before I did that. Now, we're already in a digital money situation. That's the thing, is like, how many times do people pay with cash these days? It's usually with credit cards or doing with mobile apps or anything like that. So the whole thing is the digitalized of money is one aspect of it. But I agree with the, it's basically the whole economy itself is, how is this crisis going to affect it? And I believe there's a huge shift now towards telemedicine. That's a big aspect that's been shown here, where people are looking at telemedicine as a way for the future. I believe also that the whole thing about a community is very, very important, and this has been shown in the current crisis. The one thing is the old-fashioned meaning of cryptocurrency or anything like that, that this is a negative thing, is we now know from this crisis that this is here to stay, and this is the future of it. Okay, but I always say it's like we're in digital currency anyway. It's like from the euro, the pounds, the dollars, the yen, it's all numbers on the screen. Nobody actually sees this. So my belief is, okay, the whole thing, the how we're going to get out of this is e-commerce, focusing on how businesses are going to adapt the whole digital and bring value to consumers, but bring value to businesses and bring value to governments. I think that's the three key sectors that, and also safety. That's the one thing. The whole reason this has, the virus has been so, is a fear factor in people. And human beings, we're very, very simple. We have two emotions, greed or fear. Okay. And if one is looked at, then that's the one that we have to do it. Using the digital side of things, I think, can help in regards to giving people security and giving people basically a nice situation going forward. So I believe it's the opportunities are around the corner.
And Vishal, kind of same question for you, and then we'll take some questions from the audience.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I would say that the empirical evidence suggests that there has been a greater adoption during this time. If you look at, say, something like USDC, the amount of issuance that you've seen over the last 6 weeks is astronomical. And that has to do with the fact that a lot of people that are in fiat currency in emerging markets, where they are fearful of their government's responses, or they're fearful of any sort of market response, are actually looking for safe havens. They don't have a natural access to dollars, which is still the anchoring safe haven asset across the world. So what do? They adopt the digital dollar in any shape and form that they can, right? There are various ways to circumvent, you know, actual access to dollars. And that's happening. And we're seeing that, right? Now, does this shadow economy necessarily move the hand of the private economy or the central bank economy? I definitely think that the central banks will be responsive to this. And this is exactly what China has woken up to. The DCEP that they're going to implement is going to necessarily address this. It's quite, it's ironic that it comes from a time like this, that you're going to kind of see some sort of proliferation of these sort of adoptions. But it's definitely underway, right? Again, for me, it's industry specific. It has to be, there's not a blanket approach here. But remember, at the end of the day, anything that kind of is sown in bad soil will necessarily kind of fall in the radar of anybody that's trying to put in the right seeds, right? So in this particular case, you're going to see the central banks wake up to the fact that there's a shadow economy going on with a bunch of IOUs digitally that completely circumvents KYC AML, and there's a way, they need to do something about it. Will the private sector get involved right away? Potentially, but it's not really their problem to deal with, out of the gates. So it's something that's happening. It will happen. It's not necessarily it's not something that I want to, I would like to question either now or even 3 years from now, even if we've made no material progress since. It's going to be a slow moving wheel, and I'm ready to accept that. And I'll adjudicate maybe 10 or 15 years down the road if I can.
All right, awesome. So wanted to take some questions from the audience. And David, why don't you take the first one about from Carlos Valabueno. Can you elaborate more into the concept of store value? I understand that the Chinese experiment will be pegged to gold.
I'm 99.9% sure that the Chinese digital yuan is not pegged to gold. It's pegged to the yuan, the renminbi. So that's their currency from their central bank. The goal is to perform all three roles of money: store of value, unit of exchange, medium of exchange, and unit of account. So will it be a store of value? It will be as much as the current yuan is today. And that would be the same with any currency. Is it a store of value? It is, to the degree that any currency is a store of value already today. If you think that gold is a store of value, then that's your belief system. That's fine. I don't believe in it for a second, but that's plenty of people do. Personally, I mean, just as a little, as a quick thing, I think that the main value we could tokenize would be real estate, because real estate is real value. It's not made up. And the real estate coin, if it got big enough and represented, hundreds of thousands of buildings around the world, could actually be a store of value, and maybe even a unit of exchange that would be pretty valuable as money. But that's just a thought experiment. It won't actually happen. If it does, would be decades away.
Great, thank you, David. And the next question is from Jose Diaz Cuadra. We'll give this over to Gowrie to answer. So why the banks must consider in its portfolio to invest in digital securities in its own position and for its clients?
Okay, so the question is, why does the bank have to allocate a portion of their prop capital towards digital securities? Is that the question?
I believe so, yeah.
I think, let me change it a little bit. Because banks currently, if they are allocating some of their prop capital towards speculative assets, be it within the private marketplace or within the public securities, Basel III requirements, the capital burden on such investments will make it uneconomical. The capital charge is too high. You might have to put up to 100% charge on a listed security when the bank takes it on the prop book. So the days where banks' prop capital was allocated towards speculative assets such as public securities or private market securities are long gone. Today, banks don't allocate prop capital towards that. So I think we'll change the question a little bit. Maybe what they are referring to is, do private banks have to recommend digital securities towards their clients? Probably that might be a relevant, I probably can answer that. So I will link this to your previous question about liquidity within the digital securities market. I see liquidity in two aspects. One is liquidity within the primary market and liquidity within the secondary market. Just because a company digitizes and issues its security, be it equity, bonds, units of funds, ETFs, REITs, anything, right, it's not going to magically bring about secondary market liquidity or attract primary market liquidity. What attracts liquidity in the primary market is because if the underlying investment has investment merits, that's what attracts liquidity in the primary market. In the secondary market, liquidity is brought about if there are buyers and sellers, i.e. somebody wants to sell, they believe that the value has ended at this particular price, and there is a buyer who believes value begins at this particular price. Two opposing views meet at the same time, at the same instance, and the transaction happens. That's what attracts liquidity, be it in a private market or a public market. Right. So worrying about liquidity in the digital security space is, it's not even relevant, because if there is a company which is worth investing, digitizes its shares and issues it as a digital security, liquidity will come simply because it's attracted towards the investment fundamentals or the investment merits associated with that security. And will private banks correspondingly market digital securities to their clients? Of course they will, if there are sufficient issuers who can exhibit, you know, profound investment merits, which will then, you know, add value to their clients. That's when they will market digital securities. And I believe the reason why there is a lack of liquidity, be it within the primary market space or the secondary market space, for digital securities, for the few that are actually alive in this market, it's because they are issued by startups or some small companies or a bunch of real estate in some city somewhere. If you can have a large corporate, right? Any large corporate, say for and which is a well-known brand, known to a global audience, then issuing their shares or bonds as a digital security, I'll put my money on this. There's going to be liquidity attracted towards that transaction or towards that security, and that's what's going to bring liquidity to the digital security space. Bring on good companies of big enough size where there can be enough activity within the secondary market and more enough interest within the primary market because the fundamentals support it.
Right. Great. Thank you, Gary. The next question is from Rebecca Alvarez. This will go to David. How a cross-border regulatory initiative would help to adopt digital securities? Do you think that that is possible for governments to adopt general principles?
I held a two-day workshop on this a year and a half ago, and we spent 90% of the time on ownership and 10% of the time on identity. And the rest of the mechanics don't matter much, because in many countries, you're not allowed to own your own securities. It's illegal. In the United States, you cannot own your own securities. You have to have an intermediary, some kind of custodian. And if you look at the economics of exchanges, all of this stuff is going to get centralized. And at scale, it works much better at scale. So the concept of a lot of decentralized activity and decentralized exchanging and trading going on, I don't think has any chance. So one way to look at it is, what's more likely to emerge? The company like Binance, right, which has kind of won the race and they become more compliant, or the digital exchange becomes compliant, or the non-digital exchanges that we have today, and we have NASDAQ private markets, In Europe, we have something called Turquoise by the London Stock Exchange. These are for trading private equities. And we have the major public exchanges. It might be, you know, they have the buyers and sellers, right? That's where the liquidity is. It might be a lot easier for them to adopt digital standards than it will for new, you know, digital native companies to achieve a market, right? So you might have a much better solution right here by some startup, but if the buyers and sellers aren't there, you have no market. So my guess is that the markets, who can easily build an app, will slowly transform to digital and stay compliant. And that's the sticking point. That's what's going to cause less innovation and more very gradual evolution from pretty much all the household names we have. I mean, if a custodian is forced on you, then it's going to be Morgan Stanley or Goldman Sachs, right? Because it's going to be required, then everybody's going to go with the names they already know. If it's not required, but if it's optional, then there's a whole new marketplace for solutions, and people with better technology can emerge, and you can manage your own keys if you want, and it's just optional, that then we have an open playing field. But that change, that takes agile governance, which we don't have. So maybe in Asia, as someone has pointed out, maybe in Asia is going to be much better on the regulatory front and being able to adapt to these kinds of requests, requirements from the market. That's where you might find more innovation sooner.
Awesome. So I think we'll go next to Tony for this one. So this question comes from Nikita Sachdev, sorry about if I mispronounced. I believe there's a massive custody and operational risk. However, it seems Europe is far ahead in digital securities than the US. Why is this so? And what are they doing to overcome risk? You're on mute, Tony. You're on mute.
So many people would love to have that option to keep me muted. So I take it as a compliment. So the whole thing is, okay, I'm gonna add Asia to it as well. Being is, I've lived there for 15 years and I see the whole different marketplace, because I work between Asia, I work between Europe and America. The one thing is, okay, Europe is trying to become a more digital because it needs it. It's already been a lot of securities, and they've got the digital side of it, and people are more interested in that side. In Asia, regulations have already been put into place in regards to digitalized securities and ownership and the tokenization. Okay, in Japan, they've already legalized this already ahead, which is quite amazing. In America, I think it's exactly what David said, is in regards to Goldman Sachs, in regards to into these kinds of establishments. Okay, this is where they like to keep in control. By having everything on a digital side of things, you lose power, you lose your market authority, and that scares a lot of people. What they don't understand is if they loosen up the marketplace could explode, and it could be even bigger. And the next phase, I believe, is going to be Africa, where Africa is going to be the next digital uptake of this, because they have the people, they have the economy, and the whole side of it is everything is done in Africa on mobile phones. Okay, no jokes from anybody about anything about that, but Africa is running the whole economies and everything on mobile phones, from mobile banking to payments, El Peso and everything. So the whole thing is, okay, is we have to look at it on a global basis. And the thing is, people rather do it through Europe at the moment because the regulations and the ability to do so is there.
Awesome. Thank you for that, Tony. And the next question will be going to Vishal. Coming from Mark Vernon, I'm creating a platform for tokenization of shares based on Ethereum EIP 884, specifically for Delaware companies. Any suggestions on using that standard or improving on it?
Well, I think the bigger question there is, you're using Ethereum, not to necessarily take any sort of, you know, we'll let the gavel fall either side of what my view of Ethereum is. But the point is that when you're building something on a public blockchain, whether that blockchain itself is stable, remember, it's still at the behest of a very concentrated holding in terms of node operators. But they're very intertwined. Governance of that blockchain is still highly disputed. So if you're going to build on this public blockchain, you better be very well in tune and very, at least from a risk analysis, able to predict what the obstacles are going to be, you know, coming forth. If not, then the best bet is to create a private blockchain or permission ledger of sorts. I would say that, you know, if the driving spirit here is to securitize something and you've spotted something, don't go for the default option necessarily, because it is a minefield in terms of what could come your way in the future. Instead, actually look at it from the other way around and say, okay, which public ledger, if one, or, you know, do I need to create a private ledger, is going to enable me to actually create that digitized version of whatever I want to offer. That's probably the way I'd look at it. Yeah.
Great. Awesome. And coming from Tony P, this question is over to you, David. What's the advantage of a digital dollar versus an electronic dollar, which we all have in our accounts, on our cards, Starbucks wallets, etc.?
Right. It's, you know, everything is electronic money, but the way you think of it is there's a single ledger or there's double ledger, double entry accounting. So, you know, right now we have the customer facing stuff is all banks, is all retail banks. That's the so wholesale retail, right? And there's a lot of steps to go from where we are to everybody having an account with the Fed. And one good example is that $2,000 in cash for every man, woman, and child in the United States. Now, I don't know anybody who has $2,000 in cash. I don't think anybody else here does either. So where's that money? It's in Bolivia. It's in Russia. It's all over the world. And those people have not much incentive. You need to give people an incentive to switch to an account that is at the federal bank, at the central bank. And so that means, you know, then the question is, okay, so that's not going to be zero interest anymore. That could be have to bear a bit of interest just to get people to do it. Now, the expense for that would be on the order of hundreds of billions of dollars. And central banks are quite afraid of the whole concept of what they call narrow money. So it's like you can do all the technology experiments you want and come up with cool blockchains and solutions, but on a policy level, they haven't really solved the problem yet. Now, some are willing to try, and I hope, and it's going to be the small countries first, right? It would be fantastic because China's is not a single level. China's has wholesale and retail. The Chinese government is handling the wholesale, and then they're going to let Alibaba and Alipay and the big companies handle the banks, handle the retail aspects. So the first countries that are going to go fully, you know, retail at the central bank level are going to be small. And those experiments won't count much because they won't tell us much. So I'm hoping countries the size of Sweden might go that way, and then we can learn a bunch. But as I say, I just want to emphasize that monetary policy is far more important than digitization, and that I encourage anyone listening who is interested in monetary policy to look up nominal GDP level targeting, because that's what puts our economy into a V-shaped recovery and allows more people to go back to work. And then once we have better policy, we can work on digitization.
Thank you for that perspective, David. So I guess we'll take the next question from, from Mark Vernon. And this will go to Gowrie. With startups and companies being virtual, with services sold anywhere, why can't companies be created totally on-chain with no jurisdiction and then traded in a decentralized way? Asked slightly tongue-in-cheek. And that's from Mark Vernon, yeah.
Okay, so can a company be created virtual? Means every single aspect of that entity lives in a virtual world. Yeah, but then under which jurisdiction do you fall? Where would you book your profit? Who is going to, if something was to go belly up with that entity, which laws of the land would govern it? So there is, well, I mean, if there were to be some legal drafting that can happen at the global scale and there were to exist universal laws where one can do it, yeah, the interoperability of a jurisdiction becomes automatic and that can happen, but we are not there. We are far from it. So an entity has to have a place of domicile, because that's where the entity is recognized as a separate legal person, and the laws of that land or that jurisdiction then becomes applicable in the conduct of its activities. So one can operate virtually and one can be global, but one needs a place of domicile. So there is no concept of a company existing only in the cyberspace. Number one. And what was the second part of the question?
So why can companies be created totally on chain with no jurisdiction and then traded in a decentralized way?
Securities transfer in a decentralized way. I mean, peer-to-peer. Peer-to-peer transfer of securities is possible. That's what happens anyway. I mean, okay, you go via an exchange in a private securities, few third parties will come to authenticate that transaction, but you are trading with another counterpart. Do you want to do it directly? Yes. If there exists no evil in this world, yeah, that's possible, but it doesn't work like that, you know. There needs to be a framework which governs that transfer of ownership. There needs to be, on chain, you can bring decentralized, you can disintermediate trust, but that ownership needs to be recognized under some court of law, which then authenticates that ownership and validates it. So you can trade peer-to-peer. That's made possible now in most jurisdiction, even securities trading peer-to-peer in some have come live, but you need to have a place of domicile. I don't think that's up for argument.
Okay, and next question also from Tony P goes to Vishal. There are exchanges and ATSs here in US that can trade. Same in other countries. It's not possible, it's just not easy. And that's the way it should be if you think about it. Versus the shit show, I think you meant to say shit show, with ICOs and crypto exchanges.
So, okay, I'm actually trying to figure out what the question there is. Yes, there are ATSs. Actually, there was about a year and a half ago, there was this huge ATS grab because everybody thought that tokenization was going to facilitate this new era of trading securitized assets on these exchanges. And having an ATS enables you to do that, right? The reality is almost every single token, STO, that came out as a result of it that was placed on these ATSs had no liquidity. There was nobody willing to show a price. You logged on and you saw, well, what is this? Right? It didn't really make much sense. ICOs have liquidity. The problem is that with ATSs, there's not a problem with ATSs. What will happen is that to actually trade these securities, you'll have to jump through a lot of compliance loopholes, right? You have to make sure that you're some type of accredited investor, you apply for some exemption, then you'll be able to do it. And then there's still nobody willing to make a market on it, right? Because a lot of times, as many have alluded to here, these are early stage companies, highly opaque, we don't really know what's going on. With an ICO, nobody really knows what it's worth, but everybody's doing it in bits and parts, and there is no accountability at the end of the day, right? That almost appeals to this primitive nature of humans, where it's just kind of about taking all little risk and letting it off, et cetera, so forth. At least that's what the market's telling us. I don't think that the ATS models that people ran after are actually going to yield any sort of fruition. It's highly encumbered in a lot of red tape. I just don't see it. I mean, ICOs are definitely not a solution, but there is really no challenger at the moment.
Okay.
And you have to block Americans.
That's true. All right. Well, the next question is from Ramses Vieja. Where do you think, and this will go to Gowrie actually, where do you think is the best jurisdiction to launch digital assets fundraising? US, Abu Dhabi, Switzerland. What's your take?
Hello, Ramses. I know Rambo. He's my friend. So it's ironic that you directed that question to me. Okay. So I believe the best jurisdiction to go for would be Dubai or Abu Dhabi. I think the next one coming close would be probably an Asian jurisdiction such as Singapore or Hong Kong, and then followed by Switzerland. I think this is where one can be able to launch a digital security, have it recognized by a reputable authority, i.e. the securities regulator as such, and then, you know, be able to operate within that framework. Having said that, Switzerland is the, as of now, what I know with my limited understanding is the only jurisdiction which has recognized a company can amend its corporate documents and have the ownership of the shares of that company issued on a ledger, and that ledger to be the only register of such ownership, and that is acceptable in a court of law. So Switzerland was the first to do this. None of the other jurisdictions have that provision within their...
And Liechtenstein also.
Thank you, David. Yes. So Switzerland, Liechtenstein now have recognized that. So if you can have that kind of advanced corporate laws which recognize it, then it's really nice that then you actually really are having a true digital security in terms of its at the point of issuance and also at the point of transfer of ownership. But that's not the only aspect, because it's, you need to also look at how else the jurisdictions can support you in terms of how you might want to structure it. Because one of the key elements of digital securities within the private market is to enable multiple investors across the world to be able to participate. It is meant to break barriers, and it is meant to, you know, enable access to a wider pool of investors. That is it's a consequential benefit that can transpire when securities are issued in a digital form. So from that point of view, choice of jurisdiction also matters in terms of it being able to facilitate a global pool of investors to participate. From that point of view, a country like UAE, which does not impose any income tax on individuals or at the corporate level, zero income tax. So for you to have a holding company here might be beneficial, as opposed to another jurisdiction. Then you'll have to figure out double taxation treaties and so forth, and calculate the, you know, the tax impact. So it's one less thing to worry about. And another good thing about UAE as a jurisdiction, so if you look at where we are based in the Dubai International Financial Center, or our sister emirate in Abu Dhabi, it has Abu Dhabi Global Market. So both these jurisdictions are governed by common law. So in terms of a legal framework, you'll have the common law framework to operate under. So from that point of view, these jurisdictions. So I think you can look at it on a case-by-case basis. But if you ask me, I believe, be it here in the UAE or Switzerland or, say, Singapore or Hong Kong might be good jurisdictions to as a starting point, and then you can customize from there on to serve your own purpose.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Gary. This next question is for David from Brenda Zayola. We will launch an app for loans with functions like OCR and fingerprints reader to avoid identity robbery. Can you suggest standards to use digital identity or policies to prevent it?
Yeah, digital identity is always the rocks that all the projects hit on and aren't able to get over. So identity is a big stumbling point. I'm a fan of the DID standard from the W3C. That's getting momentum. There's lots. The problem with digital identity standards, there's so many to choose from, and all we need is one. But the DID standard is self-regulated. It's self-sovereign, which is different from government issued, right? So there are a lot of different ways to do it, and it's going to depend a lot on what's allowed in your jurisdiction. And also, you know, you talk about issuing securities of some kind, whether it's a bond or whether it's debt or equity, but you got to ask where the buyers are. You can issue in Switzerland, but there's no buyers in Switzerland. Swiss people don't invest in interesting things. That's ridiculous. So fine, you can issue in a lot of places maybe, but you can't, there's no market. So identity is really hard. Don't reinvent it, but try to find the thing that is has the most momentum. And in my view, that's the DID standard. You can also look at something called Evernym. There's a blockchain for identity. It's called Evernym. Evernym Foundation, and they're trying to work with the DID standard. Really good people. It's the obvious way to go. So we're in a quagmire on identity, and it's really holding a lot of projects back.
Thank you, David. Next question, I'll turn to Tony for this, from Christopher Carmine, from the FinTech Connector. Hello, Christopher. So Bitcoin represents most of crypto, holds 67% of market cap. STOs in regards to prop tech is emerging fast based on countries' regulations. Countries that already have good STO regulation are still acquiring STOs in different countries. Where do you think the most secure STO should be acquired, Tony?
Actually, I'm going to spin the question, because you don't acquire an STO because of the country that's issued. You acquire an STO based on the business, okay? I think there's so much focus being put on the regulation and everything like that. It's a hybrid of everything. So it has to look at the regulation is one part of it, okay? Where is it issued and where is the accountability to the investor, okay? I think that is a crucial thing. It's all about where do you market it, okay? I do believe what David just said about issuing it in a country where it's an interesting one. The second part of it is, okay, what does the business do? That's what you should be basing your investment advice on. What is the business doing, okay? What is its plans? Why does it need this money, okay? I think that is more of an appropriate question for it, because looking at the jurisdiction of investing, I don't know. I don't think it could be a issue. Okay, we've just seen a lot of legal cases with different people around the world in regards to this. I think you should invest in the business, okay, and that should be your basis. I don't think you should look at the jurisdiction, because that's just going to be too complicated. And if you're investing because of jurisdictions, you should just buy government bonds. I think that's going to be the easiest one to do. Yeah.
Thank you, Tony. So this one is directly for David. David. You, and from Renata Aguilar. Thank you, Renata. David, you led the Pillar project to a 21 million ICO. Can you tell us about that experience?
Well, I wrote about it. I wrote a big piece on it, a chapter in the token handbook. And then I had to go really modify it, because we were afraid of the SEC calling us and asking us questions, and looking back at that and saying, maybe I shouldn't have written that for the public. So that era is over, right? It's all, that's just history now. And most of the tokens are dead, right? So more than 95%. And both Vitalik and I predicted that most of the tokens would be dead. Vitalik predicted it because he thought the projects were silly. I predicted it because I thought Jay Clayton was going to open his mouth and shut them down. And that's exactly what happened. The SEC has started enough lawsuits against, you know, the KIN token from Kik and the Telegram coins and the big projects. EOS is looking really bad at the moment. Many of these, if they don't end in lawsuit, they're just dead. There's no lawsuit. They're just over. There's nothing to sue. So the ICO boom is over, and it's really because of 20th century thinking and no innovation. And so I feel that's very sad. I think that there should be, my website is called permissionlessfinance.com for a reason. I don't see why we should be compliant with rules and regulations that don't work. So I have no advice for ICOs because they don't exist. But if you look at the exchange offerings, read the fine print on those exchange coin offerings. no Americans, no UK citizens, no European citizens because the passport doesn't work, maybe some Swiss people, maybe some people in Nigeria. I mean, these are really, really restricted to places that have, you know, non-mainstream regulations. And so that's not a market either. So most of this tokenized based stuff, that's why I keep saying, we are not going to invent the future by tokenizing the cool stuff. We're going to add tokens to the existing old 20th century frameworks that we already have. And then very slowly we'll get a little bit of innovation and more liquidity. But it's kind of doesn't matter because it's just the mechanics. If you don't change the regs, it's just the mechanics. You know what? In 5 or maybe 10 years, something even better will come out. Some quantum tokenization or something. It won't matter if everybody's mindset doesn't change toward innovation.
Thanks. Thank you, David.
One last thing. There's a fantastic movie from Kids on the Blockchain that just came out last week telling the whole story of the ICO boom. It's amazing. So look for Kids on the Blockchain. They just released it and all of us are in there, and it was just crazy times. It was shot as it happened. So if you really want the historical stuff, that new documentary is phenomenal. It's on YouTube.
Can you, if you don't mind, David, writing that into the chat box and then also your website, permissionlessfinance.com, so people can refer to that. Thanks so much. Next question is also from Renata Aguilar to Vishal. She would like to know the process of a token offering.
There's no set standard as to how you do this. You could go through various different ways. I guess one easy way of doing a token offering, I'll explain how we're doing ours, right? We are in the midst of raising token financing. The way the A5T token issuance works is that there's no public sale. And that way we kind of just make sure we're not going to get our hands dirty with a lot of different jurisdictions and so forth. Only exempt parties from certain jurisdictions will be allowed to participate. Whether the individuals that actually end up holding the tokens at the end of the day are able to hold them, that is not necessarily up to us, as long as we're taking the right precautions. Now, in terms of actually issuing it, it's quite straightforward. You'll either probably set up some sort of a portal where say if you're doing a public sale, which we're not, you have some where you're taking in a deposit of Ethereum, Bitcoin, Tether, whatever it is. I would probably say avoid the Tethers of the world or anything that represents a stable coin, because that's a passport to US regulations. It's still a form of dollar, isn't it? But at the end of the day, on the back end, what you're going to be doing is you're going to create a smart contract that kind of adheres to the promises that you've made as to how the token is supposed to behave. That is very simple to do. You can Google it, you'll get a lot of different answers to it. And that contract needs to be audited to make sure that it's actually behaving the way it's supposed to. And then it's very easy to distribute. This is most easily done on the Ethereum blockchain as opposed to any of the other blockchains. That's why it's been very popular necessarily. But it's as simple as that. If you really put your head to it, you'd probably be done in a week, from end to finish. Don't necessarily do it because of that. But if you've got something and you're working on something and you're absolutely sure that in terms of compliance with a lot of these regulatory oversights, you're fine and you're good to go, then that has been a popular way of kind of approaching it.
Thank you, Vishal, and thank you everyone for joining. You've been a great audience. Thank you for all the really productive questions. I'd like to just go around, the panel to just give some final last words, final thoughts as we come to a close. And we'll start with Gowrie, and we'll move around from there. So Gowrie, any final words for our audience?
So I can link it to one of the questions that I think Vishal, you took it on. One gentleman asking about a protocol that he's using for a tokenization platform. I don't think even the protocol matters. What he needs to think is if he's building a platform to tokenize shares, what is the problem he's trying to solve that I can find in that platform that the other platforms are not addressing. Unless that platform can give me that extra zeal in terms of that value addition, that is something new that they have done, or some form of something that they, you know, improves efficiency or reduces, I will be able to issue at a lower cost or whatever, some key strategic problem that an issuer might have or a secondary market participant might have dealing on those securities. If unless this platform addresses that, it is inconsequential what protocol he uses, because maybe this protocol might not be even there in 2 years down the line, and the future of digital securities is going to be interoperability, because people will be able to talk to each other, different protocols will be able to talk to each other. So what protocol you use to issue that digital security today may not be even relevant down the line. So two things to the audience in my point of view: if you are doing something, you need to solve a problem, you need to add value. And talking about protocols and all these things about that side of the tech, I mean of course you need to choose the best, but it's secondary to your, and your primary goal should be you need to satisfy a need to the market. And that's from a digital securities point of view. On money, if I may, money is a medium of exchange, right? So the future of money is sans the monetary policy implications and things like that. I think the future of money is that whatever that medium of exchange that most people are able to easily access and use, and whatever that enables, that's the future of money in terms of medium of exchange being used. So that's my perspective on that.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Gary. And Tony, we'll go with you next. For final.
Yeah, I learned to unmute. So I think it's exactly that. It's more to focus on, if you're an entrepreneur or a business, okay, what are you solving? That's the first thing, okay? What are you bringing to the marketplace, okay? Secondly is, can you execute it, okay? And what is the potential, okay? As an investor, I always look at it and go, okay, what exactly those questions that I just said before, but then looking at it, okay, what is the exit strategy? Okay, most investors rush into these projects and they don't understand how they're going to get the money back. Okay, so my approach is very simple. I have a very simple approach to this in regards, because from a financial point of view, it's from a business point of view, what are you bringing to the table? How are you building a business? What is the need, okay, and how do you build trust with your investors and with your customers? From an investor point of view is, does this business achieve the goals it's going for? Okay, what is the marketplace and how am I going to get my money out? That's the main thing, is how am I going to get my money out?
All right, over to you, Vishal, for final thoughts.
Yeah, I mean, I'll probably comment a little bit more on the money side of things, which is that we live in a society where we've highlighted that, yes, you know, we are in unprecedented times in terms of monetary policy. That actually is the case. At any given point in time, it's unprecedented, whatever the monetary policy is. But where we've expected these tailwinds, they've been thrown at the sector, right? Whether it's through alleged inflationary expectations for the future, et cetera, so forth. But without even being an economist, the key attributes that you know that are actually just extremely obvious that are going to be changing the way we look at things, take a multiple types of forms, right? One is that you are going to see a digitization of an advanced barter system, right? If you don't want to call it digital money, whatever it is, you are going to be trading more and more digitally, right? On the retail level, it may not be necessary that you experience this right away, because you have Apple Pay, Samsung Pay. A tokenized version isn't necessarily going to change your experience of anything. On the wholesale level, the game changes completely, right? Whether that, again, is private sector or central banks, et cetera, so forth, settlement processes, how they happen, whether it's a T+1 or T+2 delivery, or whether it's instantaneous, these things are extremely consequential and in terms of the cogs of the financial system. Once those start I guess, proliferating, you'll start seeing it trickle down to the retail level. And I think that it's important to acknowledge that because we are already setting sail, we have set sail in that direction. So as far as, cash transactions, et cetera, so far they're concerned, there are things that pass. We already know that's absolutely fine. But expect the world to become even more digitized in terms of the way you actually send, receive money, whether that means it's a new security altogether, whether that means it's something that you already own. But the way forward necessarily is going to be, holding something that has a, less of a footprint in its physical analog and more of a footprint in some sort of record of trust that everybody else has.
Great. And last but not least, David, some final thoughts to close off?
Thanks, Diane. Well, thanks to everyone, and thanks to you guys for putting together a great event. I really enjoyed it, and I think that there's been some good engagement, and it's been really worth doing. Two thoughts. One is liquidity is everything. If you don't have liquidity, then it doesn't matter how tokenized or digitized anything is. And so the question is, are we going to liquidize the digital, or are we going to digitize the liquid? Right. And I think because of regulation, we are going to digitize where the liquidity already is. Do I like it? No. We were hoping for an abundance of liquidity and that we'd get much more liquidity in all markets through tokenization and, peer-to-peer transaction. And that's just being shut down left and right. So I think we're going to find that where the liquidity is where we're going to have the innovation. And that's going to be slow. And I just don't see a boom. And the other thing I want people to be aware of is that most people in the crypto industry who are pundits and who already have a lot of Bitcoin and who are promoting Bitcoin, they want you to understand Bitcoin is money. I really don't think Bitcoin is money. I think it's an asset. And I think it responds, for example, when the Fed prints more money, the price of Bitcoin goes up because it's an asset. It's not money. It's not an alternative. And that's my view. And I would be careful. I want people to understand the difference between Austrian economics and monetarism and Keynesianism. And I teach classes on these. But the Austrians believe that gold is money and they believe that Bitcoin is money. And they're not going to hear anything different. So you're going to hear a lot of very strong opinions about that. And I ask people to look at the facts. When you hear that inflation is bad and this is the Weimar Republic is coming back and it's going to be hyperinflation, look at the facts and see if they support those claims. I've just put a video on the chat that is a one-hour interview with my favorite economist, Scott Sumner, that I just released yesterday on this topic. So if you're really interested in and talk about things like inflation, understand it first before you just repeat what you hear on the interwebs.
Awesome. Thank you so much. And just to answer a question from the Q&A, David, if you can confirm or deny that IMDb link is the new kids on the blockchain video that you had mentioned, just take a look at that whenever you get a chance.
I put the link in the, it's youtube.com, new kids on the blockchain is, the link is in the chat.
Great. So Jose Luis Cerezo, check out the
chat. Yeah.
And, I'll turn it over to Angel Lorente, our founder and I guess CEO of FinTech Connector, to give their closing remarks.
Thank you, Diane. And thank you for that introduction as well. I am Angel Lorente. I am the founder and CEO of FinTech Connector. Hope everyone is doing well. But I want to start out with, this was a fantastic panel. The amount of information shared. We're recording this. I'm definitely going to go back and listen to this again because there's a lot of great nuggets of information that were shared. Diane, you did a fantastic job moderating this group, controlling this group. Because hey, let me tell you, these are some these guys have some alpha in them, and they have some great information that they were sharing. I want to thank Sophia and Miguel, our Mexico community partners of FinTech Connector, for organizing this. This was their event. They organized it. They got the speakers together. So really, thank you. And we should applaud them as well for putting this together. And lastly, I would definitely thank the attendees. A lot of great questions, a lot of great engagement, both on the chat and through voting on the polls that we sent out as well. So really, thank you, because especially in this new world that we live in, this new virtual world where we can't see everyone face to face, judge body language. So a lot of the way that we see the engagement is through the polls, is through the questions, is through the interaction in the chat. So thank everyone that actually did that today. Now I'm gonna do a little bit of a selfish plug for FinTech Connector. We are having our next event on June 4th, which is our member, this is our members only event, Town Hall, which is enabling the next normal with FinTech. It's going to be a fantastic event. Diane will also be moderating that one. So if you think she did a great job here, come on back. She's gonna do a great job then as well. So please come and do that. Again, if you're a non-member, we invite you to join FinTech Connector to stay plugged in. We have 2,700 members in over 100 countries. So, and our goal is how do we connect people, opportunities, and capital, both human and funding capital, to innovate and create the next generation of financial services innovation. So please look us up, go on our website, use the link that I shared in chat to join. And we would love to have you as well be part of our community and continue to engage there. Lastly, we put out a quick event survey here. Please vote on it so we know how, whether you want to do this event again. At some point, invite some of these speakers back or all of them back to do version 2.0 of this, because I think this is still an evolving topic. There's still a lot to be learned, a lot to be talked about. And we got some quality people here that actually know this very well. So we would love to invite you guys back for version 2.0 at this at a later stage. Hopefully you will come back. And that last thing is, I really want to thank you again. Please put a virtual applause in the chat for everyone here and we'll share that. But most importantly, please be well and stay safe during these unprecedented times. And until our next event, until we're back together, have a great weekend.